In this video, we're going to talk about the 8-point grid. For the longest time, people thought design is something that you're either born with or you don't know how to do. But design is a science. It is something that you can learn and acquire with practice. And the 8-point grid is a huge hack in this direction so that you can master the science of layout and arranging your elements on the screen with balance, with layout principles that constitute a huge aspect of designing, especially for a product. The most important benefit of the 8-point grid is it allows you to design with your developers in mind. Developers eventually are your main stakeholders. They are the people who will take your designs and transform them into the actual product. And developers do work with a code system. They work with numbers. They work with math. So you may be using your eye to decide alignment and create things aesthetically, but it is very important to keep in mind that whatever you're creating will translate into numbers that have to be coded. As a designer, it will allow you to maintain consistency, scalability, and proper alignment with your developers. When your developers turn on dev mode to inspect your designs, what you design in pixels will be translated into REM, and that's the value that they use for coding responsive designs. So every time you see a 1 here, that's an exact 16 pixel. It's 1 REM, which is the normal route used in most companies and systems for spacing. Every time you see an odd number like 1.6 REMs, you can tell that this designer has not followed a grid and they're using a random margin that is broken into decimals. Those sizes were not well defined or are not respecting a grid system. Now let's dive into the file and create grid styles for desktop, tablet, and mobile that will allow you to create easy layouts that are well balanced, respecting layout principles in design. I'm gonna click F to select a frame. I'm gonna start with a desktop, and for that size, I'll select a 1440 by 1024. This is one of the most common desktop sizes. I'm clicking F again, and I will select a tablet, iPad mini, and one more time, F, and we'll select a phone. We're gonna get started with the desktop. Go under layout grid and click the plus icon to select a grid. And by default, Figma has applied a 10 pixel grid on my desktop. I'm gonna go and click 8. Now it's an 8 pixel. And what this means exactly is each one of these squares will be an 8 pixel, enabling us to follow the 8-point grid rules that we've mentioned before. Do you see those four dots here? I'm gonna click on them and we're gonna create a new style, which I'm going to call component. But we're gonna use this grid style whenever we wanna create an actual component later on. Like we mentioned before, when you're designing for a desktop, there are two things that you need to use. There's horizontal alignment and vertical alignment. So for horizontal alignment, what your developers generally use is columns. So I've added a grid, the default Figma grid. I'm gonna click on it right here. And you see under the dropdown, I'm gonna remove the grid. I'm gonna select columns. 12 columns is what's commonly used for a desktop alignment. So I'm gonna keep that. The type that I want is stretch because I want this grid to change according to the size of the desktop. So I may not always use 1440, but I still want it to apply. I'm gonna select, we can select any margin that we want. For now, let's apply 32 pixels from both sides. When I click that, you can see the 12 columns moved inside. And for gutter, I'm also gonna use a number that's divisible by 8 or 4 to stay within the 8 pixel grid, and I'm putting 24. With my desktop selected, once again, I want to create another grid that will allow me to align elements vertically. So I'm gonna click the plus again, and this time, instead of a grid, I want to select rows. And the count can be anything. I'm just gonna go for 300 for now, in case my page is long. The type, you wanna change that from stretch to top, because I want my rows to start at the very top of the desktop. The offset should be zero and the gutter should be zero. Now that I have these rows and these columns, I have the ability to create shapes that can be snapped vertically and horizontally to the grid. These two layouts, I want to make them as a single style. The four dots icon to create a style, clicking the plus here to create a grid style. I'm going to call this one desktop and create style. So coming to my iPad mini, click on the selected styles and apply the desktop. I'm going to detach from this one because we wanted to edit it. So this is the icon that allows you to detach from a style. Now I'm detaching from it, which will allow me to further edit it. I don't want to change anything about the rows because this still applies. The only thing that we want to change is the number of columns. On an iPad, generally, for responsive design, we move from 12 columns to 8 columns. So I'm changing that. And you will see this changes the number of columns. I can leave the 32 pixel margin. We can make it even a 16 pixel margin if we choose to, just to have more space. And I will create a new grid style that we will call tablet. The iPhone to create the last style, and under grid styles, layout grid, we're gonna select tablet with it selected here. Now I detach. Once again, we're keeping the rows, and take a guess with the columns. On an iPhone, we move from 8 to 4. Now we've got 4 columns. We want to make sure that we've got 16 margin. Leaving this here. Once again, we'll create a new grid style, and this time we will call it mobile. And there you have it. With nothing selected, you can see we have created 4 grid styles, one for desktop, one for tablet, and one for mobile, that will allow us to design responsively and change how we want our layouts to be on these 3 types of devices. I'm gonna show you a pro tip for moving your elements much more easily when you're working fast. So in Figma, there's a nudge amount. What that means is if you move an object with an arrow, left or right, it moves with 1 pixel. However, if you use shift and arrow down, it will move it by a bigger amount. So to view your nudge amount, if you click command comma on a Mac, or you click on your preferences, you will see the nudge amount right here. Small nudge is 1 pixel. Big nudge, the default in Figma is normally 10 pixels, which will make your objects move in an off way, off the grid way. But if you put your big nudge to 8 pixel, now they will be moving perfectly within the grid. Now, knowing this rule, does it mean we have to turn into robots and always use math for designing, always use a grid? Not necessarily. But as a product designer, once you understand how your work gets translated and viewed by developers, you will know the rule. You will follow the core principles, like having a system of defined margins. Whenever you feel the need to break that rule to create something aesthetic, you definitely have the full freedom to do that. It's just essential to create something scalable that can be reused by your team to follow some basic design layout principles, especially with the new Figma variables being utilized right now for design systems. I hope you find this helpful and that you can use it to be better aligned with your developers and stakeholders.